So we're at FutureNet World in London. I'm with Fahim Sabir. He's Director of Network on Demand at Colt. Fahim, great to see you again. Thanks very much for taking the time to talk to us. Now, in general, in the industry, network APIs and the exposure of network capabilities has been a really big topic in the past year or so. You know, where is Colt in its network API journey? I mean, this is something you've been working on for a while, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, we've been actively involved in this topic. A number of years ago, we actually started the initiative with AT&T and Orange in MEF. And since then, we've been going through the whole exercise of defining the APIs, developing the APIs, and now starting to onboard customers onto those APIs. It's been a real success. You know, I think the work that's been done there has been really, really important, and it seems like they're now starting to get some traction, and you know, a good number of organizations that are now starting to implement them.
Right, so, yeah. But I'm sure it's not an easy process, because you can't just go, oh, I'm going to expose some APIs now. I mean, there must be quite a big run up to this, quite a lot of moving parts, as it were.
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, I mean, it is, besides defining the APIs, it's, you know, all of the implementation, all of the mapping. I mean, in our model, what we've done is, because we built it on top of our network on demand platform, we've been trying to enable full end-to-end automation. So, you know, theoretically, somebody can basically use the APIs and they can have a live service within 5 minutes, you know, from starting that interaction with us, which is, yeah, I mean, it's a great achievement. But I guess the biggest challenge that you have with the whole API conversation is more with the partner. So when you go to a partner, you can't just tell them, here's a bunch of APIs, please start using them, because on their side, it's an IT project. It has to be budgeted, it has to be planned, business cases have to be written. So, you know, the run up to actually getting an integration live is actually quite significant. But, you know, what we've seen is standardization has definitely made a lot of that project easier, you know, because it's a, especially if they've done a standard-based API before, it definitely shortens the amount of time, because it's more about, well, actually, let's just point it and then test it and make sure it works, and maybe do a couple of tweaks to it, rather than a full-blown, you know, 6 month, 100,000 euro project, which is obviously a lot more difficult to justify, especially depending on the volumes, because in the past, all of the integration has been done based upon volume. So I would integrate with a supplier that I'd buy, you know, 10 circuits from a day, and I wouldn't integrate with a supplier where I buy 3 circuits a year. But now that balance is starting to shift. So, yeah. Fascinating area.
Okay, and so what is the end result for the, you know, the customers down the line? I mean, does this just make their life a whole lot easier, and it must improve the customer experience in many ways?
Yeah, I mean, that's the aim. I mean, obviously there's two sides of this coin. So the operational cost is clearly one of the areas where we need to focus. You know, we're in a market which is, you know, the price erosion is a very, very big thing. But also, yeah, from an end customer point of view, there is a massive difference in experience, because, you know, there are no manual hands that these things have to go from. So they get an answer quickly in terms of a service that they want to buy. They can buy it straight away. And if there's automation within the partner themselves, you know, it can get delivered like in near real time. So yeah, I mean, it's great like that.
So you've mentioned automation there quite a few times, and that's a real big theme at this event. And this is something Colt's been working on for quite a few years, I know, and you started going down the cloud native route pretty early as well. Where are you in terms of, you know, automating your processes, and to what extent have you been using AI applications to do that?
Right, I mean, yeah, okay, so a couple of questions. So in terms of automation, as you said, we've been going down the automation journey for a number of years. We have introduced our network as a service platform on Colt on Demand. Our SD-WAN offering also is a co-managed offering, so customers can go online and adjust their SD-WAN themselves. And yeah, it's been an interesting activity, to be quite honest with you. I think generally speaking, compared to the market, I think we're a little bit ahead. The I mean, you know, we've gone through the challenges. We can see others that are going through the same challenges, the challenges like, you know, data quality and, you know, trying to deal with different generations of network infrastructure.
Right.
And the such like. And yeah, I mean, it's, I think that basically you have to plan for automation in order to make automation easy for yourselves. Otherwise, you know, you can't just take existing processes, existing products, etc., and just try to automate them, because every bit of work that telcos do have been optimized
right.
for manual work. So yeah, and obviously I'd like the other side of it is the cloud native, which is an interesting expression in itself. I'm not actually sure what cloud native really means. I think it's it means different things to different people. But I mean, you know, in terms of actual sort of virtualized capability, in terms of, you know, towards the end of last year, we launched our on-demand virtual router capability. So you can basically stand up an internet connection with a router, which is a Juniper router in the background, running on an NFV stack, and it's fully orchestrated end-to-end. The aim is to now carry on that path and just basically introduce more and more functions that customers can implement, like in the core of the network, so that we don't have to deliver appliances. We take away the cost of that, and not just that, but the customer gets it the moment that they want it.
Right.
And they can resize it to bigger ones, smaller ones, without having to worry to, you know, in terms of space and power and all the other fun stuff that customers typically have to deal with when you deliver hardware appliances.
So,
okay. So yeah, we're moving in that direction in terms of our software platform, fully microservices. Fully microservice based, completely deployed on Kubernetes, and you know, CI/CD, and basically all of the appropriate sort of techniques and tools that have been used from a software development point of view. I think we've established that pretty well, and it's working wonderfully for us. In terms of AI itself, so AI is another one of those topics that's always really interesting. So, cutting through the fluff between the AI washing, if you like, and actual AI, whether it's like good old AI versus generative AI. I think we're pretty early in that journey. We're trying to feel our way around it. We've done a couple of proof of concepts. So we did one proof of concept that was based around a network on demand platform, whereby we would automatically scale bandwidth of services based upon previous customer behavior.
Right.
So, you know, if we realized, let's say, for example, that a customer decided to, you know, they maximize their bandwidth users at 5 p.m. every day. So we would actually figure out they would do that. We would tell them, and we would actually update the bandwidth or increase the bandwidth at that time and decrease it at, let's say, for example, 8 o'clock, where usage kind of tailed off. So we had a bit of a play with that. It worked pretty well. We also have looked at some sort of predictive fault detection.
Right.
In our network. So, you know, monitoring certain characteristics of the network, like, you know, abnormal power usage in core network devices and the such like, to try to predict when something was going to break so we could fix it before it broke rather than after it broke.
Yeah.
So those are the two use cases that we've experimented with so far.
Okay.
Neither of them are in production yet. Otherwise, from an organizational point of view, you know, we're in the process of rolling out generative AI capability to the employees across Colt. So, you know, to help with productivity and, you know, the such like, and all of the work that we're doing in with regards to any sort of systems updates in terms of we have an initiative going on at the moment called Colt.io, which is all around a refresh of our core BSS, OSS platforms. And, you know, the AI requirement is absolutely core in those activities, so that, you know, the systems are helping to manage tickets and manage accounts and, you know, provide the right sort of advice to the users that are using them to help them basically, you know, make sure that we're doing what we can to delight our customers. So, I mean, that's what it's all about. So,
sure.
You know, we've got an industry leading NPS score, and our mission is to, you know, not sit on our laurels in that respect and just continue to basically push the envelope in that respect.
Okay.
So yeah, I mean, but relatively early in the journey, lots of interesting stuff to look at.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Now, of course, the other side of the picture here, which you were mentioning before, when we were chatting before this interview, is that it's not just how Colt is using AI. You've got your enterprise customers are using AI, and that in itself has an impact on you as the service provider and partner.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think over the last sort of couple of years, we've been through a couple of sort of generational shifts. So obviously the first one is, the move to cloud computing basically changed the whole profile of how the network was being used. And everything was basically then starting to go towards the cloud. Internet connectivity became more important as one of the primary mechanisms for accessing SaaS type services, or even, you know, IaaS, PaaS type services as well. So we had that step. We had another step, which was the COVID step, whereby basically, you know, the office, the enterprise building became less important as a center of users. So, you know, customers were being distributed, you know, kind of tied into the emergence of SASE and the such like technologies like that. And yeah. I think kind of AI is the next generational shift. So it's kind of interesting. You know, there's a number of questions that need to be asked. So first of all, who is going to own the GPU farm? Yeah, I mean, that's the key one. You know, are we going to see the likes of the hyperscale cloud providers that exist in the market today? Is it going to be them? Is it going to be a certain manufacturer that basically, you know, builds GPU? Are they going to become a cloud provider in themselves? You know, it's certainly something that could happen. Mm-hmm. So you know, are we going to see a shift in terms of where the traffic is moving in that respect? Expectation is the fact that, you know, sensors, from an IoT point of view, are going to become more important, because now you can actually start to do something useful with the data that they actually produce, you know, right, processing that data. So, you know, rather than, you know, you could end up in a situation whereby you've got different types of data, all the way from, you know, occupancy data, which is just like a numeric feed that basically hits once every whatever minute, just a one byte every minute, or you could go for full sort of 4K video that's being pushed over towards the cloud, and, you know, all of that data needs to be consumed. Will it get processed locally on the provider edge, in the provider core, in the cloud? You know, so you basically will likely have different steps where that data will actually get consumed. And, you know, and also you can also think in terms of generation of content as well. So if you look at, you know, the gen AI type stuff, you know, generation of text, generation of video, generation of imagery, you know, the customers are going to want to, our users are going to want to download that stuff back to their machines. So, you know, you have that requirement as well. So I think what we're going to see is quite a lot of change in terms of where the hotspots of traffic are going to move to,
right,
because of this whole because of the whole way that AI is being used to process data.
Yes. And have you had any customers sort of ask about, you know, like GPU as a service or something like that? You know, because that's starting to crop up now.
So not in any conversations that I've been involved in. I'm pretty sure. There's always conversations happen at Colt, so I'm pretty sure somebody will have. The question is, where is that GPU? I mean, you could have it on the customer's site in I'm careful not to mention UCPs and such like, because, you know, that turned out really well. But I mean, you know, is it going to be the next generation of UCP type technology, edge type technology, or the such like? But yeah, you can definitely see it happening, because, you know, you need that sort of power to process that sort of quantity of data.
Yeah. Well, things are moving pretty fast. So, you know, just in the past year, the number of the use cases and business models around this have evolved pretty quickly. So I'd expect by the end of 2024, we'll have completely new set of services, a lot of new ways of working, and a lot of different demands from the enterprises as well. So look forward to catching up later in the year and finding out what's been affecting Colt. But Colt, of course, is a much bigger company now as well. You know, there's a major acquisition, so you've got greater scale, more and more customers to engage with, so that must be pretty exciting in itself.
Yeah, I mean, it's at the moment, it's pretty much all hands to the pump, trying to basically move forward with the integration. I mean, you know, the integration is at multiple levels, so, you know, yeah, there's a cultural integration at the people level, which is, you know, regarded in our organisation as being the most important part. You know, the you know, a lot of acquisitions, mergers fail because you've got two separate cultures coming together and not enough work is done to actually put it together. But then also at the technical levels, integrating the networks, integrating systems, well, actually migrating data into Colt's core systems. So we have one network, one core set of systems, one team basically coming together. And yeah, as you can imagine, there is a lot of energy going into that activity. And I think we're making good progress. I think we're on plan on that.
Well, I think you've got a management team that's very focused on all of those issues and not leaving anything behind. So that seems to be the way things are working. Fahim, great to talk to you. Thanks so much for joining us. And let's speak again later in the year and find out how things have evolved.
Yep, let's do that. Thanks very much.